Dean Cesar Villanueva to proceed to the holding area while the interview on Associate Justice Teresita De Castro is being conducted. Thank you.
I do not know how to address again Justice De Castro. She was my PJ in the Sandigan Bayan. So anyway, would you mind call you Justice Tess? Okay. So any manifestation, ma'am, before we start with the questioning?
May I be allowed to make a short opening statement?
As we did to the other candidates, we limited the opening statement to 3 minutes. Can you do it in 3 minutes?
I hope so.
Okay. Go ahead then, ma'am.
Good afternoon, Honorable Chairman and members of the Judicial and Bar Council. Should I have the good fortune of being appointed Chief Justice, I will bring to this lofty position my 39 continuous years of service in government, 19 years in the Office of the Chief State Counsel of the Department of Justice, and 20 years in the judiciary. I joined the government and rose from the ranks through devotion to duty, integrity, commitment to excellence, without reliance on any personal or political connections, but always with the assistance of the divine providence, the unseen hand which charted the course of my career in government. It is my long years of service in the government which helped shape my judicial philosophy and my reform agenda. My government service started when I was still under bar. I took the screening examination here in the Supreme Court, and I was hired as a law clerk with a salary of 500 pesos a month. That was in February of 1973. Later on, I served in the office of Chief Justice Fred Ruiz Castro. So what are the lessons that I learned while I was in the Supreme Court during that early time in my career? I was already at the time understood the importance of fostered the spirit of professionalism and my adherence to integrity in public service. It was also during my stint in the office of Fred Ruiz Castro, the former Chief Justice, that I come to realize that docket congestion is the most serious problem of the judiciary. At that time, there were already 400,000 cases pending in court, from the lowest level up to the Supreme Court. And Chief Justice Fred Ruiz Castro was very much concerned of these clogged court dockets. So he proposed to President Marcos the creation of a presidential commission which studied alternative modes of dispute settlement, and that gave birth to the Katarungang Pambarangay Law, Presidential Decree 1508, which I helped draft during my service in the Supreme Court under Chief Justice Fred Ruiz Castro. The neighborhood conciliation system proved to be very effective. I know this for a fact because for a long period of time during my stay in the Department of Justice, I was a member of the Lupung Tagapamayapa. Later on, I was recruited by the Chief State Counsel whom I met in the Katurungang Pambarangay Project to work in the Department of Justice. As I was first hired as State Counsel 1, then I became State Counsel 2, State Counsel 3, 4, 5, 6, then Assistant Division Chief, then Division Chief, and finally Assistant Chief State Counsel. In the Department of Justice, I served 8 Secretaries of Justice, beginning from Vicente Abad Santos, Macaraig, and so forth, until the last one was Secretary Chofisto Gingona. And it was during the incumbency of 3 presidents, President Ferdinand Marcos, President Corazon Cojuangco Aquino, and President Fidel Ramos, who appointed me to the Sandigan Bayan. During the incumbency of President Marcos, I was a junior lawyer, so I worked in the background. But I had a golden opportunity of working directly with President Corazon Aquino and President Fidel B. Ramos, who awarded me a Presidential Medal of Merit for my exemplary service to the government during the peace negotiations. At the Department of Justice, I have worked on diverse and significant legal and constitutional issues confronting the political branches of the government during tranquil and normal times and during perilous and trying times in our national history, from the effectivity of the 1973 Constitution, the Freedom Constitution, or the Proclamation No. 3, which was promulgated by President Corazon Aquino during the existence of the revolutionary government and under the 1987 Constitution. What are the lessons that I learned at the Department of Justice? First, it is loyalty to the institutions of government, to the Constitution and the law. I have learned through my long service in the government that public officials come and go, but institutions remain. So we should all be loyal to the institutions of government, the Constitution that give it life and substance, and to the laws that gives it form. Second, I also learned that it is important there be stability and predictability in our legal system. The opinions of the Secretary of Justice, although persuasive in character, establish precedents or rules intended to guide future actions. So it is imperative that legal questions are consistently decided in accordance with law, so that persons similarly situated can be guided in their action and expect the same ruling in the future. This is important for stability and predictability in our legal order. The third lesson that I learned is that the political branches of the government are equally concerned with the constitutionality of their actions. The Secretary of Justice as Attorney General renders opinion for all heads of government, departments, bureaus and offices, the Office of the President, members of Congress, constitutional commissions. And in the course of this work, I came to realize that legislators, together with the President, are so much concerned with the constitutionality of their actions. And that is precisely why they ask the Secretary of Justice if their actions are within constitutional bounds. It is only when actual cases are elevated to the court that the power of judicial review is invoked and exercised. So in the first place, the political branches of the government, Congress, and the Office of the President would have the first crack of determining the applicability of the Constitution to whatever decisions they may take in the course of their exercise of their functions. They have all the vital information that they need in making policy decisions. The President especially has access to security and intelligence information, technical studies, empirical data, which are not available to the court. And therefore, it is for this reason that I believe that the judiciary should, in the exercise of its expanded power of judicial review, should exercise circumspection and utmost care.
How many more minutes, Justice Tess?
Maybe 2 minutes. Your Honor.
Okay, ma'am.
So I also learned that
with the promise of 2 minutes.
Too long minutes. I also understood the importance of technology. At first, we were using electric typewriters. Then we shifted to computers and word processors. It was a difficult adjustment, but it turned out to be very good in the long run. So I believe that we should emphasize also the introduction of technology in government service. I had greater exposure to this when I was promoted to the Sandigan Bayan and later on to the Supreme Court. So I, at the Sandigan Bayan, what did I learn? You know, I was not from the judiciary. I came from the Department of Justice. But my work in the Department of Justice helped a lot in the discharge of my functions in the Sandigan Bayan. And that is where I learned that experience really is the best teacher. So when I took over the Coco Levy case, in 6 months, I was able to decide that that case the decision of that case has long been delayed. It has been in court for 16 years already. Now, because of my exposure to legal issues, legal problems in the Department of Justice, it took me a very short period of time to dispose of that case. I also was able to harness the legal knowledge that I gained in the Department of Justice and was able to use it for the benefit of all judges and all members, together with the justices in the judiciary. The step increments, which is allowed by law since 1982, was not applied to the judiciary. It was already 1997 when I joined the judiciary, and that was the only time that I initiated the process of applying this step increment to all members of the judiciary, and true enough, it was approved by the Supreme Court, and because of that, all judges and justices now enjoy the step increment, which allowed them to have a salary of the next salary grade without being promoted, simply by their long service in the judiciary. Now, I also learned that the judiciary is not for the weak of heart. It's not for the timid and for one who is afraid to take not only a great responsibility, but a responsibility which may cause a tremendous personal consequence, not only to oneself, but also to one's family. I went through this in the course of my work in the Department of Justice. So I was given the fortitude and the courage, without any fear of consequence, to deal with cases involving powerful and influential persons. I have understood since then that public office is to be wielded for the common good and not for personal gratification. I learned too that keen understanding of the government bureaucracy is important. Having risen from the ranks, I understood the plight of government employees and their sensibilities, even those in the lowest echelon of government. So as presiding justice, I avoided any appearance of extravagance. I was very judicious in the expenditure of public funds. And in my 4 years as presiding justice, I did not purchase an official vehicle for myself. I just used the vehicle that I inherited from my predecessor. And that was until I was promoted to the Supreme Court. I saw to it that promotions and allocations of court resources were based on objective and uniform criteria. I treated my colleagues with courtesy and respect so that I can motivate them to cooperate with me in the judicial reform programs that are being undertaken at that time in coordination with the Supreme Court. And this earned me the Supreme Court Judicial Reform Award from Chief Justice Hilario Davide. I also knew that it is important to be able to reach out to other government institutions and agencies, because it is only in this way that you can expand your vision and perspective and be able to avail of the resources that can improve work efficiency. In the Supreme Court, I'd like to inform the JBC that I am now the working chair of the First Division. I have been elected by my peers as vice working chair of the Committee on Ethics and Ethical Standards, and I chair three more committees: the Management Committee of the Judicial Reform Project, the JRSP Working Committee, Component A, Improving Case Adjudication and Access to Justice. I'm chair of the Committee on Computerization and Library. I am co-chair of the Halls of Justice Coordinating Committee. I'm chair of the Committee on Gender Responsiveness in the Judiciary. I'm chair of the Special Committee to Draft the Rules on Sexual Harassment. I am member of the Committee of Internal Rules of the Supreme Court and of the Committee on Publication of Court Systems Journal and the Supreme Court Committee on Public Information. The Management Committee of the JRSP coordinates the implementation of all the components of the Judicial Reform Project. And I am committed to pursue these components of the Reform Project, which are improving case adjudication and access to justice, enhancing institutional integrity, strengthening the institutional capacity of the judiciary, and the stakeholder support for reform and program management office. That would include the IBP, civil society, and the community. Apart from all this, I am now the president of the Philippine Women Judges Association since 2009. And within this period of time that I have assumed the presidency of the PWJA, I have brought the PWJA to international prominence, which led to my being chosen as the president-elect of the International Association of Women Judges, a world organization with members from about 108 countries. So, Honorable Chairman and members of the Judicial and Bar Council, I would be ready for work from day one if I am nominated and appointed Chief Justice of the Supreme Court.
Is that all, Justice Tess?
Yes.
Yeah, it was indeed a long 12 minutes. Yeah. Okay. Now, Attorney Cayusa, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good afternoon, Justice De Castro.
Good afternoon.
Actually, most of the questions that I had prepared have already been answered with your presentation, but I just have a few more. As the Supreme Court Committee Chair on Gender Responsiveness in the Judiciary, I know that you have had several seminars on gender sensitivity and responsiveness, but have you had a chance to monitor how effective these seminars and this orientation have been in promoting gender sensitivity?
We have a committee which is in charge of that. And I think right now they are trying to come up with the criteria to be able to determine that. But as of now, we try to see to it that the Supreme Court is gender sensitive. For instance, we look at the number of employees and see what is the ratio between women and men. And we also see that if we want to find out if our employees are following the rules that we have put in place, to see to it that in the court, the employees and officials are gender sensitive, like in the use of their language. We have come up with a gender sensitive language book, manual, and we want to find out if they're following this. Even the court has come up with rules as to how we will address women and children who are victims of crimes.
Thank you, Justice, because I know that that is very, it's very active in the Supreme Court, but perhaps there is need to monitor how the effects, if any, on the lower courts. Moving on, you are the president of the Philippine Women Judges Association, and there are more and more women entering the judiciary. Proof of that is that more than half of those whom we interview are actually women. What programs or what do you think can be done in order to effectively harness the, you know, the resources that you have among women judges in order to promote the administration of justice?
Before I answer your question, I would like to, the PWJA would like to thank the JBC and the president for the numerous appointments and promotions that our women judges had so far been given. In fact, we find it difficult now to look for replacement because every time there's a movement, we have to replace the directors and the officers. And that was because of the numerous appointments and promotions of our women judges. Going to your question, you're asking about what we can do to...
What projects have you done in the PWJA to harness this? Well, it's good that actually we do consider a lot of women judges for promotion and all. I mean, of course, based on merit, not just on gender. But I would like to know if you have other ways of harnessing, you know, their capabilities towards helping in the administration of justice.
Yes, in fact, we hold regular meetings, and during our meetings, we discuss how we can help improve the administration of justice. We, not only in terms of the performance of judicial work, but in the clogging of prisons, the decongestion of prisons, extending assistance to prisoners in order to alleviate their plight. We have also professional development projects for the judges. We in the PWJA, we see to it that judges, our women judges, are able to avail of available opportunities to improve their skills and their knowledge. And we were able to send some of our women judges abroad to study on a scholarship and also to attend domestic seminars for professional development.
Thank you, Justice. Now, on another note, well, actually, you outlined several proposals in your opening statement as you gave a summary also of your career. Among the proposals that you stated in your opening statement, which, well, although you were not able to complete the presentation, we were given copies prior to your interview, which would you consider a priority?
Improving the case adjudication. As you know, as I have mentioned earlier, this was the congestion in the court's docket was a problem in the 70s when I was still a young lawyer. And now it's already the 21st century and still we have this problem. And the cases from 400,000 in the 70s has gone up to 700,000 now. And so I think that while we have been implementing reforms, I believe that we need to do more. And there are a lot of measures that we can undertake to be able to improve the adjudication of cases and make sure that we can speedily dispense justice. It is there are several ways. One, we can look at the rules of procedure and see how we can reform our court procedure to be able to speed up the disposition of cases. Our problem when I was in the Sandigan Bayan, one major cause of delay was Rule 65. So we had workshops on how we can limit the number of cases being elevated to the court with the use of Rule 65. We have also introduced a lot of measures here to improve the rules of court. We have speedy ways of dealing with the small claims cases, not only through improvement of the rules, but also through computerization. We can also make use of the alternative dispute resolution mechanism. Mediation, as you very well know, is still at its early stage, and there is a lot more room for improvement in terms of the professional development of the mediators. They are given trainings, but I think they are not really that in-depth. They need to have available not only here in the Philippines but abroad. And there's also a problem about improving their salaries or giving them more salaries. And aside from that, the problem with mediation is that there is no regular budget for it. So we're relying on the fees. And we need more resources for the PhilJA to be able to concentrate on mediation. I am a keen advocate of this alternative dispute settlement mechanism, because I myself experience how this can declog the court docket and how mediators can not only settle disputes but ensure peace in our society. And the Katarungan Pambarangay, although we cannot do anything to expand the jurisdiction of the Katarungan Pambarangay, because that will require a legislation to amend the Katarungan Pambarangay, but perhaps the judiciary can support that. We are still relying on the penalties provided in the old in our penal code, which was taken from the Spanish penal code. And so if we go by the penalty provided for crimes under the revised penal code, there will be a lot of cases really excluded from the Katarungan Pambarangay law. So I think that we should give priority to that, because the lack of public trust and confidence is brought about by the delay in the disposition of cases. The more cases we have before our courts, the longer it takes for them to decide the case. We were told that the way we are treating cases in court is like distributing delay. Because, the courts would schedule 10 or 12 cases in a day and then let this case be heard for 30 minutes or one hour so that everyone will have time to be heard. But litigants expend a lot of money to go to court only to be heard for 30 minutes or for 1 hour, and then the case is reset for after 3 months or 4 months. So our system is really contributing delay among all the parties litigants. So when I was a presiding justice in the Sandigan Bayan, we were experimenting on continuous trial. It is difficult to just impose it right away, but it has to be done gradually. So what we did when I was there was to select simple cases where the crime involved is not so difficult to deal with, where cases where there is only one party involved or one accused involved, because there are cases there where there are 25 accused, and these 25 accused would have 25 lawyers. It's so hard to hold continuous trial in that case. So we were starting with simple cases, and I think we should try to see, experiment on that. I didn't know what happened when I left the Sandigan Bayan. I no longer was able to see what happened if they continued with the experimentation. So there are so many ways of improving access to justice, making it more speedy, making it more efficient. And we just need to have this political will to be able to do it.
Thank you, ma'am, especially on your emphasis on court annex mediation. As earlier told by Justice Carpio, our success rate is 78%, which is quite high. So that's an average of seven out of 10 cases referred to for mediation are actually settled. Mm-hmm. And that really dramatically reduces the court docket, plus the fact, and perhaps many do not know this, that you don't have to be a lawyer to be a mediator in court annex mediation. And no matter what the amount involved is in the case, a mediator gets the same fee. Okay, so it's something like 700 or 800 pesos. So it's really, actually, it's also public service. It's a form of public service to be a mediator. And I think it's necessary for them to get the right support through training, so that we can ensure the continuity of the program. I just have two more points, ma'am, if I may. In your long career in public service, do you recall of any instance where your independence was put to test when you had to make a decision against the wishes of the appointing power?
I'd like to say that I have been very lucky in the course of my career, whether it was in the Department of Justice or here in the judiciary. I have never experienced any pressure at all. I was allowed to do what I believe was right. Because if you have established that reputation, that you know what you are doing, and that you have integrity, I don't think any false. Fortunately, I have not experienced anything like that in the course of my long career in government, whether it was in the Department of Justice. I'm very happy to have very decent superiors in the Department of Justice during all the time that I was there, and even now in the judiciary.
Thank you, ma'am, for that answer. And for my final question, if appointed Chief Justice, a lady Chief Justice at that, how would you characterize a De Castro court?
I'd like to be remembered to be a court which is independent, where independent, efficient, where integrity is upheld, and where people have trust and confidence. And that we want to be remembered, I want the members of the court to be remembered as models of exemplary behavior and decency.
Thank you, ma'am. With that, I wish you luck. Thank you, Justice Leonardo De Castro. Mr. Chairman, I have no other question. Thank you.
Thank you. Attorney Mejia, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good afternoon po, Justice De Castro.
Good afternoon.
I understand, and based on our record po, you were previously nominated as, or you were previously interviewed as for the position of Chief Justice already. Were you shortlisted?
Yes, I was.
Okay. Kung halimbawa po na kayo ang napili noon, what would have been a De Castro court today?
I would hope that there was no impeachment. That I would not be subjected to impeachment. And that we're able to continue on with our work. in peace.
Talking about the impeachment, as you know, the one of the major issues in the impeachment was the SALN, no? Kanina po, paglabas ko, may nagtanong from the media sa akin, Sir, why are Supreme Court justices hesitant to submit their SALN? Sabi ko, alam mo, ba't ako tinatanong mo? Hindi naman ako. Sabi ko, itatanong ko yan mamaya. So, itinatanong ko po, is there hesitance really on the part of associate justices or justices of the Supreme Court to submit their SALN? Kung meron man po, why?
No, I don't think there is hesitance. Because when we were appointed to the Supreme Court, there was already that old guideline. So we were just... Okay. ...adapted. The court was worried about harassment being done to the justices by disgruntled parties. Now, if in the spirit of transparency, since you know that was a long regulation was adopted a long time ago, and many things have changed since then, there is greater demand now for transparency and for accountability. So I believe that we should give in to the popular demand and lay everything out anyway. We're not hiding anything from the public.
Thank you po. You mentioned earlier, no, in fact, in your opening statement, that you have formed the opinion that the court should exercise its expanded power of judicial review with utmost care. Can you please expound on that?
The power of judicial review exists within our system, constitutional system, where there is a separation of power, a system of checks and balances to ensure coordination, a harmonious coordination among the three branches of the government. And I have come to know in the course of my work in government that the legislators and the president oftentimes are required to make policy decisions. And their policy decisions are based on many factors. The members of Congress have to know the pulse and the sentiments of their constituency, the people who elected them in office. So do the president. He has a constituency to, it's a bigger audience to address when he takes official action. And aside from that, they have technical information which are not within the reach of the court. The president is concerned about national security. He would have classified information on military matters, technical studies on matters affecting the economy, and he is confronted with the problem of our overseas contract workers. Not only because they are sending us dollars and helping the country through their remittances, but also these thousands and millions of overseas contract workers have families here in the Philippines. So the president has to take care of them. We have our foreign relations. Other countries may restrict trade, the export of Philippine products if we take a particular action that is not to their liking. We are attracting foreign investment. There are so many things that the president would have to attend to. So the court should understand that we do not have all of this information, and so we should be very careful in declaring unconstitutional the acts of officials in the political branches of the government.
How would you maximize po in your court the role of the court administrator?
I think the court administrator must be proactive. you should be able to reach out. You know, in the course of the implementation of the judicial reform project of the court, I had the chance to go around to meet with our judges. And I know that face-to-face discussions between ranking officials of the court and the judges on the ground will contribute a lot to solve problems and to speed up the disposition of cases. Like, for instance, in Lapu-Lapu, it took me only two meetings with the judges there, and there was a marked improvement in the disposition of cases. I had to go to Lapu-Lapu because that is a model court. And so I think the court administrator must be accessible to the judges, spend enough time hearing them, listening to them, and discussing with them the problems of the court.
Nang pagkakataon yung ano, yung ibang naimungkahi na katanungan para kitanong sa inyo, no? Yung iba po, comment at suggestion. Ito siguro, kung magbubutuhan siguro at hindi appointment, palagay ko, baka manalo kayo by popularity. Kasi po, sabi niya, maari bang i-consider ninyo na yung mga bar, yung mga bumabagsak sa bar, yun na lang binagsak nilang subject sa bar, yun na lang ang kanilang i-take? Ano po ang opinion niyo tungkol doon?
Hindi naman masamang pag-isipan yan. Lalo na kung matataas ang grade sa ibang subjects. You know, when every time that we are deliberating on the passing mark in the bar exam, I always take into account those who are to be disqualified. Kasi I have known a case where this examinee could have topped the bar, but he was disqualified in one case. So there may really be cases where it is not just to make them go through the entire examination, but this will require a lot of study, and perhaps we need to evaluate. I don't know if we're capable of evaluating the examinees individually, because it's so hard in a situation like that to generalize. So perhaps we could first take some statistics to see how many failed just in one subject but got very high in other subjects for us to reconsider this policy of the court.
Thank you po. Ito ho, natugunan na ni, ano, nasagot na po ni Justice Abad kahapon, pero paulit-ulit po yung tanong. Siguro, baka hindi nakikinig kahapon itong nagtanong nito. At hindi lang po isang nagtanong. Baka po maikling ano lang. Short comment po, again, dun sa trial by jury. Mukhang sabi ko nga, marami ang nabibighani sa panonood ng ano, ng law and order. So can you please again give us your take on the matter of adopting trial by jury? Briefly lang po.
I'm not in favor of adopting trial by jury. You know, in the US, that has a very, very long history. It's part of their culture. Hindi yun parte ng kultura natin eh. And I don't know if the citizens will be willing to devote time to the trial of cases. And sometimes there is also that problem. In the US, they have a problem with that. They need to orient the jury members. Orient nila, they need to be told what are the issues, what they should look for. So that will put additional strain on the operation of our justice system. In the U.S., they allow this in both in criminal and civil cases, but to a lesser extent in the case of in civil cases. But I know they are encountering a lot of problems because they are paid. That's additional expense. But the pay is not also enough for them to leave their family or to leave their work. And there is also a problem, I think, in the U.S., before, they want to make sure that the jury members do not read the news, do not watch the television, or do not know anything about the case. But how can you do that now with the internet and all these gadgets? You cannot anymore sanitize the jury members. You cannot seclude them from what's happening in the society. And I think the important thing in the jury system is that the members of the jury do not know anything about the case, have not encountered anything in connection with the case, so that they can be objective. They are finders of fact. In the jury system, the jury finds the fact for the judge, and the judge would apply the law. But there are also occasions where the judge do not agree with the jury, so you add more conflict in the criminal justice system, and there is disagreement between the judge and the jury.
So yun po, sana nalinawan yung mga nagtatanong, kasi ang dami pong nagtatanong, no, tungkol sa jury system. May final question po. Paano ninyo maitataguyod ang women empowerment sa Supreme Court?
Sana marami pang ma-appoint na lady justices, lady judges. Kasi I say this because if you consider the ratio, there's still a big gap, no? We have only 609 lady judges and justices from the highest court down. And this comprise about 33% of the entire membership of the judiciary. So I think in that area, there can still be room for improvement. And I don't have any gender bias against the men, but I'm just saying that from my experience, I feel very much fulfilled working with the lady judges. I would not have been elected president in the International Association of Women Judges if it were not for the cooperation that I got from the officers, directors, and members of the PWJA. Many of them are very diligent, very capable and competent, very dedicated to their work. And I think the Supreme Court can utilize their spirit of cooperation of women judges to be in the implementation of our judicial reform projects in the Supreme Court.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good luck po, Justice De Castro.
Justice Lagman, please.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. Justice De Castro, good afternoon. During the impeachment trial of the former Chief Justice, the moral fitness of a Chief Justice came out. In your perception, what is moral fitness, which should be one of the criteria in nominating and appointing a Chief Justice?
I understand moral fitness to mean not simply obeying the law.
Yes.
Because you should transcend that. You must see to it that your actions are in accordance with the, proper, decent, and that you do not go beyond the bounds of ethics. So it's not enough to say that I'm obeying the law, I'm following the law. But we should be very careful in seeing to it that we observe decency, propriety, and ethics in all our actions. And not only in our official actions, but also in our private life. We should be models in our community, models of moral fitness.
Okay. Being the, you have stated that you are the vice chair of the Ethics and Ethical Standards Committee in the court, so I'll ask you this question. It is of common knowledge that the judiciary now is burdened by an image of corruption allegedly committed by most of its members. Now, former chief justices have tried to address this problem, but apparently they failed because this problem still persists up to today. If you will be appointed as the next chief justice, how are you going to root out the corrupt in the judiciary?
I think it is important for us to have a feedback mechanism.
How are you going to do that?
Yes. We should enlist the support of the integrated bar and the community in this feedback mechanism. I don't have yet the form of this feedback mechanism, but I think it's a way of putting members of the judiciary on their toes, knowing that
they are being watched.
They are being watched, and that we should have a standard criteria to evaluate judicial performance.
So, can you explain further what you mean by standard criteria? What is the standard criteria that you wish to implement?
Right now, the court is working on this, and it's really a difficult undertaking. Because, you know, sometimes there are judges who write very well, so it takes them more time to write their decisions, and these decisions are not usually affirmed by the higher court. Mm-mm. There are those who produce a lot of decisions, but they are all reversed. So there are many factors to take in consideration, and we have a problem about finding who should evaluate them. They do not want to be evaluated by the executive judge because they feel they are just peers, and their work is not reviewed by the executive judge. So we should really look into this, have a scholarly and well-studied measure to evaluate the performance of our judges.
Are you telling us that your basis for evaluating the performance of the judges will be their decision, the percentage of affirmance or reversal of their decisions?
No, not only that. That's why I said we should study the criteria that we should use in evaluating judicial performance, and it cannot be as simple as that. There are many things that we should consider.
Okay. Now, Justice De Castro, what to you is accountability? And how are you going to promote accountability in the judiciary?
Accountability is accountability means being responsible for your action. It is not enough that you are not found out, because you know you all somehow some way you're going to pay for whatever wrong you have done. There's a higher being there watching over us, and so for me, accountability is not only something legal, but it is spiritual. It transcends what the law demands of us. And I think we should instill this sense of accountability through our Philippine Judicial Academy. The institution in the Supreme Court, which is taking charge of educating and developing the skills and the orientation of judges, I think we should see to it also that legal education is reformed. I think we have paid very little attention to ethics. It's just a one unit course in college. Mm-hmm. So I think we should be allotted more units and given greater weight in the bar examinations.
Okay. Now, considering that the Legal Education Board is under the supervision of the Supreme Court and the Chief Justice in particular, how are you going to regulate the law schools in that regard through the Legal Education Board?
The Legal Education Board can decide on the curricula of the colleges of law, mm-hmm. and I think this is a very potent way of looking at the administration of our law schools. I think the Legal Education Board has enough authority under the law to be able to reform our educational system, especially the law schools. And I think the Supreme Court should be more active. This Legal Education Board has only been recently organized.
Ah, yes. So it has not taken off.
I think the court should have a better or closer coordination with the Legal Education Board. Anyway, it is within its supervision and not just let it do its work without any supervision from the court. So I think that's one area which the court should also pay attention.
Okay, Justice De Castro, I have here some questions. In fact, there are many questions from our Twitter, which are all directed to you. And I want to ask you these questions. Okay, Justice De Castro, this is from a certain FCA. Justice De Castro, what can you say about the masses, rallies, banners, no work day in the Supreme Court during the impeachment to show support to a justice facing charges?
I didn't have a hand in the planning of these activities. Mm. What I just want to say is that anyone who tells me that there is a mass going on in the Supreme Court, I usually attend, whether it is for one purpose or for another, whether it's for First Friday or for any occasion, I would go to mass and attend the mass. Now, aside from that, during the mass, we pray for everyone.
Okay. We pray for a particular person.
Not for a particular person, okay. But we pray for everyone. Mm-mm. And I think prayer is very, very good.
Yes.
In fact, I ask so many people to pray for me now.
Okay. Okay, so, that's very good.
So
the power of prayers.
Yes.
Now, another question from a certain Felipe Natanyo. How should the Supreme Court balance its response to people's demand for openness and transparency while guarding against tendency to become populist? How should the Supreme Court balance its response to people's demand for openness and transparency while guarding against tendency to become populist? From a certain Felipe Natanyo.
I do not perceive anything wrong with being populist, if it means that we need to be sensitive to the sentiments of the greater number of
people.
Our population. I don't see any conflict between these two ideas. I'm both for transparency and also for seeing to it that we feel the pulse of the people without, of course, going beyond the bounds of the law.
Okay. Now, one last question, Justice De Castro. Just from Renza Riola, Justice De Castro, has there been a time when you totally opposed a certain decision of the Supreme Court?
Is it about writing a dissent or?
Yes, where you have
completely
dissented.
Yes, I do that if I really believe that I have taken the right position.
So in relation to that, another question is this. Has there been a time when you regretted the action which you have taken in a case which you have decided?
Fortunately, I have no regrets for any decision that I have done. I have never flopped or changed my position in the course of my work here.
So you have never flip-flopped?
No.
Okay. So on that note, Mr. Chair, I have no more questions for Justice De Castro. Thank you, Justice.
Thank you. Justice Hermosissima, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good afternoon, Justice.
Good afternoon, Justice.
Have you been, before you joined the government, have you been in the practice of private practice of law?
I had some experience in handling family cases. So it's not completely zero, but I would say that these are cases which were elevated up to the Supreme Court.
I was hoping that you... Justice Munoz Palma, Justice Amor Herrera, had the ambition to become presiding justice as the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. If you're appointed Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, you will be the First Lady Justice of the Supreme Court. Do you realize that?
It will be a great honor, but at the same time, it will put a lot of pressure on me to be able to prove that I'm worthy of the position.
So if you are appointed Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, what would be your judicial philosophy? Would it be different from your judicial philosophy as a mere Associate Justice of the Supreme Court?
I will be guided by the principles that the former Chief Justices of the Court have pursued all along, and that is dedication and adherence to judicial independence, a judiciary that is efficient, competent, that is able to earn the trust and confidence of our people, and which is humane and compassionate.
So what is your concept of justice?
Justice is giving everyone his due under the law.
Is it any different from the definition of social justice by Chief Justice Laurel?
It's different in a sense because social justice is limited in concept. It pertains only to the state being able to address the needs and the needs and the demands of the less privileged members of our society, and the needs of the greater number of our population, whereas justice in a broad sense may not have that social implication, but it may refer only to, say, a particular individual who is before the court.
You have any shorter definition of your judicial philosophy? You have made it quite long. You see, when you enter the portals of the Supreme Court of the United States, you will find emblazoned there the words equality under law. In the Supreme Court, what do we have? Batas bayan. In your case, what do we have? Well, in the Integrated Bar of the Philippines has this to say: no master but law, no guide but conscience, no aim but justice. In short, what is your judicial philosophy?
A judiciary that is dedicated to the rule of law.
So, on what basis do we write our decisions? On the basis of law, of course. The law applied to the facts. So, if the law does not abide by your conscience, will you follow the law?
Yes, Justice, definitely.
If the law does not agree with your concept of justice, will you follow the law?
Of course, Justice, the law must be followed regardless of our personal opinion.
What will you do if the law is not in accord with your conscience, or if the law violates your concept of justice? What do you do?
I should still follow the law, because the law is the expression of the will of the majority of our people, expressed through their representatives in Congress. And I cannot impose on the majority my own personal conception of what is just or what is unjust. And that is the cornerstone of an ordered society. We cannot go by our own personal biases and opinion, especially so if you are a judge. You have to obey the law, because otherwise there will be chaos and instability in our constitutional system.
Madam Justice, considering the unmitigated proliferation of deaths caused by violence of judges, journalists, and other private individuals, are you in favor of the revival of the death penalty law?
Personally, no. I'm not in favor of reviving the death penalty law or allowing its imposition.
So you do not believe that the death penalty law is a deterrent to the commission of such crimes as murder, parricide, rape, and kidnapping?
From what I see from the cases that go up to the court, it seems that it has not been a deterrent. The problem is the environment that these criminals find themselves in very often. It's not the law that is, it is not the law which will make them avoid crimes or heinous crimes. Sometimes they are forced by the environment where they live. And so I think I go for restorative justice.
Will you not change your mind if I tell you that quite recently, the Federal Supreme Court of the United States upheld the constitutionality of the death penalty? This in spite of the opposition of American bishops to the imposition of the penalty of death. But four Catholics in the court voted in favor of the imposition of the penalty of death.
If it is provided for by law, I would do the same thing, Your Honor.
What the clamor now is whether we you agree to revive the death penalty law.
That is not the only solution to the problem. I think there is a lot of reform that we should do in our society to be able to eliminate heinous crimes or lessen the commission of heinous crimes. But it will really take so much for the state to be able to do that, considering the state of our nation today. We have there are unemployed, there are people who are poor, but or we cannot eliminate this, but I think we should focus our attention on alleviating the plight of the poor. You know, crimes are committed because sometimes there are a lot of rapes committed by fathers or uncles or brothers because they live in a very small place, and I think just imposing death penalty without improving the lives of the poor will not achieve the purpose of minimizing the commission of heinous crimes.
As a Chief Justice, or even as an Associate Justice, you should have your ears to the ground and watch out for matters which might come up to the Supreme Court for consideration and deliberation and judgment. Now, Congress is starting deliberations on the RH bill. Whatever you say here will not bind you if you become the Chief Justice. As Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, it is only proper that you have your ears to the ground, so to speak. The issue here in the foremost issue here in the RH bill is whether it violates the constitutional provision which holds that the state should protect the life of the unborn from the moment of conception. Now, question is, does life begin at the implantation of the fertilized ovum in the mother's womb? So what are your thoughts on this matter?
I think the crucial word there is conception. And that is I think it's very technical. I cannot give offhand the meaning of conception. So when is their conception? Is it from the time of the union of the, it's this, the egg and
the ovum.
And the ovum. And can we determine that? Can that be determined? Is there any medical way or scientific way of determining where there, the precise time when there is such a union of the sperm and the ovum?
This is only a test of your of the things that will come up before you when you become Chief Justice. That is just an example. So that needs a lot of study.
Yes, that needs a lot of study. We cannot just go by the language of the Constitution.
On that note, thank you very much. Thank you for coming.
Thank you, Justice.
Secretary Mosgi, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Magandang hapon po, Justice De Castro, Your Honor. I believe the material you submitted is sufficiently comprehensive to allow me to form an opinion already. But I just want to be very clear about one other thing. I understand you are the president of the Philippine Women Judges Association, and during the interviews, you evince a good bias on women. If I may be able to ask you then, do you think that corruption is gender sensitive? Do you think that men judges are more susceptible, more vulnerable to corruption rather than women?
I really cannot say that. I think it's more a personal thing. It's maybe it's in the genes or or in the environment where you grew up. Maybe the association that you had in the past or at present. So it's, I don't think gender has anything to do with it.
Okay, Madam Justice, I wish you luck. I have no further questions, sir. Mr. Chairman.
Ito ang mahirap sa panghuli eh. Wala na sana akong tatanungin, but I will just ask some questions. I hope my questions will not be too many. This morning, Justice Carpio was asked about problems in the judiciary, and he said, you agree with him that our number one problem is delay, you know,
yes.
And that we have to declug. You know. And he came out with solutions that we have already implemented. We came out with the small claims. And with due respect to the lawyers, we do not anymore allow lawyers to represent clients, no? Not because lawyers are the one causing delay. And that decisions are now made in small claims one day long, di ba? Then he said that we also introduce judicial affidavits as form of direct testimony in special rules, no? He said. But I did not ask him this question or my observation. Would you agree with me that the cause of delay is not only attributable to the court? There are other factors, is it not?
Yes.
I give you an example. I don't know if you agree with me. Ang tendency po kasi ng Pilipino eh, mahilig mag-file ng kaso eh. Hindi ho ba? Oh, tingnan mo. Highly publicized na insidente. Nag-umpisa lang sa ejectment. Highly publicized siya na. Nag-issue ng BP-22 Talbog cheque yung ejectment ng multiply ng 10 kaso dahilan may BP-22. Pagkatapos noon, yung may-ari ng apartment, pumunta doon, away sila. Nag-file ng light coercion, grave threat, unjust vexation, ang dami na. Pagkatapos noon, yung nanguupa ng bahay, bumelta. Nag-file din ng grave threat. grave coercion doon sa may-ari. Hindi ho ba? Hindi ba isang cause din ng delay? Kung ipapail mo lahat ng kaso yan eh. Nag-umpisa lang sa ejectment, nag-multiply, naging 15. Eh meron to ho ba tayong control doon? Sa husgado? Justice test. Magagaling ka pa sa observation ko?
Yeah, you are right. In fact, the problem can be solved only with the cooperation of the integrated bar in the community. The integrated bar can help a lot in seeing to it that the lawyers follow the ethics of their profession, mm-hmm. that they are made to realize that being a lawyer is a profession. It is the pursuit of a learned art where public service is important and earning a living is only incidental. But I think lawyers lose sight of that. If they even forget that they are officers of the court and that lessen their inclination to earn money, especially through
so ang suggestion mo,
encouraging court litigation.
So ang suggestion mo sana justice test, yung those incidents, mga lawyers should have advised their clients, pag-settle na lang, ejectment lang eh. Yung may-ari ng apartment, ayaw magbayad yung nakatira doon eh. Ayaw umalis eh. Magbabayad kuno ng BP22. Hindi, nag-multiply na. Hindi ho ba? So, another one is, what is your opinion? No? Because the maximum amount in small claim cases is 100,000. Beyond that, you go to the regular procedure. And this time, the parties will not be represented as counsel. Would you agree if we increase the maximum amount covered by small claims from 100,000 to 200,000 pesos?
You fully agree, considering the value of money now.
Eh, paano yung mga lawyers? Nakasamahan mo nandito eh.
Kailangan nga, they should realize that yes. Being a lawyer is being part of a profession.
Isa pa, observation ko rin, I don't know if you will agree with me, we were both in Sandigan Bayan, kasi sabi nila Sandigan Bayan, medyo mabagal ang maraming kaso. Hindi ba, sometimes also the cause, yung laws mismo din, sometimes I'll give you an example, and I hope you will agree with me. Doon sa anti-graft law, sa Republic Act 3019, Section 3E. Yung isang empleyado hindi lang ni-promote. Magpapail ng case Ang ini-invoke 3E, causing undue injury through evident bad faith, gross negligence. Hindi ho ba? Nakakaabot sa atin yung kaso sa Sandigan Bayan Hindi ho ba?
Kasi very broad yung language.
Yung isa naman, gusto mag-travel abroad. Pinaburan ng mayor, ibang pinag-travel niya. Ipapail din. 3E rin, hindi ho ba? Di ba meron hong ganun? Maraming ganun.
Yes.
Yung mag-retire na empleyado, hindi lang ibigay agad yung retirement pay niya. Papailan yung mayor. 3E na naman Hindi ho ba? Tama ho ba yun? Justice test.
These are minor cases which are decided by the Sandigan Bayan. There will be three justices sitting.
Anong remedyo natin doon? Legislation, hindi ho ba? Amendments isa pa. Kaya pinag-uusapan namin sa NBank Yung sa TEP at saka Estapa. Ang value 12,000 to 22,000 pesos. Ang penalty yun beyond probation yun 6 years and 1 day ang penalty noon 12 to 22,000. Nagnakaw lang ng 15 or 18,000 I-convict mo yan, hindi na makapag-probation. Hindi ho ba?
Kasi galing pa yan sa Kodiko Penal ng Espanyol.
Ngayon, if you amend those provisions sa penalty sa TEP at saka Estapa, if the amount is between 12 and 22,000, lower the penalty, probationable, sa tingin ko, marami na magpo-probation Sa TEP at sa Estapa Hindi ho ba?
Pati dun sa katarungang pambarangay. If we go by the penalties provided for by the revised penal code, there will be many minor crimes which should be outside the jurisdiction of the Lupon.
So ang sa clag dakes ng husgado is not only the concern of the court, because we have been doing many things in the court in order to expedite the termination of cases. Hindi ho ba? Tama ho ba ako?
And you know, we need the cooperation of all the branches of the government.
Okay.
If I think many do not know that in the first level courts, dun sa municipal trial courts, there are no lawyers there except the judge. Imagine there are thousands of cases pending before the municipal trial court, and the judge normally judges do not have a lawyer to assist them. And it is very unfortunate that judges are overworked, understaffed, and unappreciated. We are being criticized left and right in public, but I think people should know that there are many dedicated public servants in the judiciary. Our judges are working under very dire conditions, and yet they stay on. There may be some who are doing not good things, but they do not comprise the majority. And I think we should be able to project to the public that the court is not as bad as they think it is. And I think our problem is that, especially us in the Supreme Court, we do not want to appear before the media to explain. I'm glad that yesterday Justice Brion had the opportunity to explain one of the cases.
He will have also the opportunity, because that's my next question. Because one of the concerns of the candidates in the first day of the interview, wala daw tayong work plan, but I told him that meron, ano ha? But I could not follow up questions, kasi he was surprised when I told him na meron tayong committees, may plans, ano ha? I think you are the right person to answer, no? To answer if indeed we have plans. Now you chair the Supreme Court Judicial Reform Support Program Management Committee. Can you explain to us what is this committee all about?
This is the committee in charge of coordinating all the reform projects of the Supreme Court. And the reform project the reform projects fall under four categories. There's component A, this is improving access to justice and improving case adjudication. Two, we have component B, which is improving institutional integrity. The third one is component C, which is improving institutional capacity. And the last one is encouraging multi-sectoral support. And that would include, as I mentioned, the IBP, the community, civil society. So this is a very comprehensive plan. This was well thought out. This was scholarly done since the time of Chief Justice Davide. But in the early part, you know, we have been trying to study. We just cannot implement reforms without conducting studies. So studies were done. And you just do not give computers left and right. There is some... You need needs assessment. You just do not say that this office should be given 4 computers or 5 computers. You need a thorough study. There is a need to see to it that the financial measures and the budgeting of the judiciary is being done in accordance with well-studied criteria.
So, So the management committee, that's the main committee.
Yes, it's the mother committee.
Yeah, mother committee, and you have four subcommittees.
Yes. Now,
you had the mother committee and the subcommittees, no? The subcommittees.
You chair one of them.
You jumped the gun on me. So the four subcommittees are headed by different justices.
Yes. Okay. And I think what we have here is a unique arrangement. We were told that there's nowhere in the world where justices are actively involved in judicial reform. They usually focus on their attention to writing decisions. But here, the justices are taking active part in judicial reform. All the committees are headed by a justice and usually also assisted by two or three associate justices.
And do you actually meet on a regular basis?
Yes, you know when the Hall of Justice in Angeles City was being constructed, we meet every Monday.
So that's also part of the management program. That's included in the management program.
We have two pilot courts. One is in Lapu-Lapu and the other one is in Angeles City.
Which brings me to another question, because I see lawyers from Manila. Most of them are my friends. Eh, ang tanong eh, ikaw din pala in charge ng Halls of Justice eh, di ho ba? Oh, sa committee mo eh. Ang tanong nila, eh saan ho yung Manila Hall of Justice?
Malapit na.
Can you tell us if funding has been already secured?
Yes, sa GSIS, the former GSIS property in Arroceros, and we already set aside more than enough money for that.
Oh, will it be?
I think 1 billion something.
I think it's 1.8 billion for the EC court in Manila Hall of Justice. Okay. Kaya ata nandito yung mga Manila lawyers eh. Yun natang gustong pakinggan eh.
There are 100 mansion in the future will be possible.
Sa'yo lahat.
Because there might be new salas created in Manila.
Yeah. And all these programs, no, that you have been undertaking, and all these meetings, all the things that you have done. No? Ang tanong ko dun eh, meron ba tayong sufficient funding? Kasi iba yung meeting tayo ng meeting eh. Meron ba tayong sufficient funding to fund all these programs? Computerization, Hall of Justice, enhancement, lahat. Meron ba tayong funding dyan, Justice Tess?
Meron tayo. Yes, we have. We have some funds allocated for that. But computerization is really very expensive. If we think of the entire nation or the entire judiciary, we need a lot more money to be able to do that. But for piloting, I think we can.
Yeah, there was another. I do not know if I can. You can answer this question. I understand you are also the one in charge of the World Bank loan. Yes. What committee is that?
Part of the management, it's under the MANCOM, it's under the management committee.
It's also part of the JRSP? Yeah, it's part of the management committee, MANCOM.
The entire reform program consisting of these four components are funded by World Bank. But the term of the loan already ended last June.
Yeah, I ask you this. Because there were concerns, a lot of concerns. Everybody probably read items in newspaper that there was something wrong with the manner a part of the loan was spent. Can you tell us how much is that amount involved?
I think the amount of $115,000. Were treated as ineligible.
Yeah.
Not illegal or irregular. Treated as ineligible.
That $115,000 is how much percentage of the whole loan?
That's a small percentage because the loan was about $21 million.
So $115 was considered
ineligible.
So in local auditing, if it is a government money, it is an amount that is disallowed.
It's not disallowed.
Oh, it's not even disallowed.
It's there is just a problem about where to charge this amount. Should it be charged to the government counterpart fund or to the World Bank loan? You know, the World Bank sometimes would ask that expenses be agreed upon. Like, for instance, just to give an example, well, this was not the ineligible expenditures. I had nothing to do with them. This was done at the project management level. Yeah. So we are not engaged in the disbursement of funds. None of the justices ever touch any money in that World Bank loan. We have nothing to do with it. Now,
what happened with that query?
There was from the
reports that the World Bank was trying to secure an explanation from the court through you.
There was a request that the matter be discussed, but according to them, we can point out errors in their aid memoir. So originally the amount I think was about 160,000 US dollars. Then after some discussions, it went down to 115,000. Now this amount were spent on the, say, payment of an employee of the court who lectured about docket congestion. So the allowance given to that Supreme Court official was considered ineligible. So they're saying that should be paid by the GOP counterpart fund. Now, someone was invited to go abroad to share information about our mobile courts, the Ijaudi, our mobile courts, and they said that it should not be charged to that. We had a visitor, the Chief Justice of Guam, who was treated to lunch in one of the restaurants here in Adriatico. They said that was not agreed upon with the bank, so that was that was considered ineligible. Those are minor expenditures. Nothing spectacular about the disbursement of those funds. And I'd like to point out, ineligible does not mean irregular. It should not be charged to the loan, because according to them, you did not secure our agreement. So that means if somebody lectured or somebody went abroad, you have to secure the consent of the World Bank that it should be that.
In other words, if there was no consent, that should not have been sourced from the loan from World Bank, from the counterpart loan.
So if you will look at the aid memoir, many of the objections there would be not agreed with the bank, not agreed with the bank. So the bank did not say it's irregular or it is unlawful. It's just that there should have been prior agreement with the bank, with the World Bank.
Aside from your work as a working chairperson, you explain to us what do you mean by working chairperson
in the first division?
Yes.
As working chairperson, I perform the same functions as the division chair. Review all the reports being submitted by the members of my division. See to it that the agenda are prepared on time. See to it that the minutes are approved by the justices, and also they are released. If there is any resolution that needs to be released in advance, I need to see to it that there is a good reason for that. So that is debated to me for approval. Then I also review the ponentias of the other justices in the same way that
they review also your
review
ponentia.
Also my ponentia. And unfortunately, the sharing, I do not get the same
number of
cases. In comparison with the other regular division
chairperson.
So I get the full number of cases allotted to a member of the division.
In other words, you are an acting chairperson because actually the chairperson of the first divisions is the chief justice.
Yes, the chief.
Because the chief justice has many things to do, instead of the chief justice presiding the first division, the fourth senior member of the court shall act as the working chairperson of the first division.
Yes.
Because the chief justice is the presiding officer of the en banc sessions.
Yes, and so because of that, since I perform the same work as as the other division chair, I should get the number of cases assigned to me should also be reduced.
Yeah. I was reading.
But that has not been done for 2 years.
Yeah. Dito may tanong dito eh. Kailan dapat pati ako tinanong din eh. Ito oh, itong tanong. I will read ah. It's up to you if you want to answer this question. Pati sa akin marahil tinanong din eh. Do you think your appointment as Associate Justice a reward for the era of conviction? Eh, galing sa Twitter ito, so I have to ask Justice Tess.
I don't think so. I've been in government for a long period of time, and I think I deserve my position. In fact, I think it was delayed. It was delayed because of the Arab case. Because they wanted someone who has been there from the beginning.
Lastly, kasi I was reading your what you had done in the Sandigan Bayan, no? But I was trying to read something important to the Sandigan Bayan. Eh, wala rito eh. Hindi ho ba ikaw ang responsible yung lupa sa Baguio City where where a courtroom of the Sandigan Bayan is now constructed?
Yes.
Bakit hindi ho muno inilagay dito?
You know, I came to know about that land in Baguio because I was a member of the Committee on the Disposition of Idle Government Lands when I was in the Department of Justice. So I know that there are properties of the government which were lying idle. And because of that, I recommended to the presiding justice, it was Justice Nazario then, that we can, maybe that is one opportunity for us to be able to secure a piece of land in Baguio. And we were fortunate enough to have 2 hectares in Baguio City.
Did we buy the lands? Did we buy?
No, it was given to us for free, gratuitously.
Okay, on that note, Justice Tess, I'm through. You are now excused, Justice Tess.
Thank you. Permission to leave.
Granted.
And that concludes the Judiciary and Bar Council's interview of Justice Teresita Leonardo de Castro. Let's go back to some of the key answers she gave us this afternoon on her judicial philosophy. She says a judiciary is one that is dedicated to the rule of law. The law must be followed regardless of our own personal opinion. She said we should still follow the law. This is the expression of the majority of the people through their representatives. This is the cornerstone of an ordered society.